Yeah, it's connecting now. Okay, great. Just quickly. Okay, good. Okay, hello everyone. Welcome to the first event of Rethinking Economics India Network. Great to have you all. Think about like what is Rethinking Economics. So Rethinking Economics is an international network of students, academics, and professionals building a better economics in society and the classroom. Through a mixture of campaigning, events, and engaging projects, Rethinking Economics connects people globally to discuss and enact the change needed for the future of economics and to propel the vital debate on what economics is today. The Rethinking Economics India Network is the national network of the global Rethinking Economics movement and looks to organize locally against a background of social movements of which we are one part, operating as a nationwide ecosystem of stakeholders in the space of pluralist and heterodox economics. We interface with individuals, universities, and civil societies in order to scale collaborative efforts for teaching, learning, and discussion, and build a movement for economics that is pluralist and inclusive. So for our first event, we wanted to start with introducing heterodox economics and why is it important and how does it fit particularly to the Global South. For that, we are excited to have two prominent young academics. So Surbhi Kesar is an assistant professor of economics at Azim Premji University. Her research areas include political economy, development economics, labor economics. She's involved with the Young Scholars Initiative of the Institute for New Economic Thinking, Diversifying and Decolonising Economics Initiative, and many other organizations. Ihsaan Bassier is a PhD candidate in economics at the University of Massachusetts. He has previously worked in the capacity of a researcher with the South African Labor and Development Research Unit of the University of Cape Town, and has been involved in the heterodox space, being founding member of Decolonised Economics at UCT in 2016, and engaged with the Rethinking Economics for Africa. So thank you both for coming to the event.
Thank you.
Great having you. And this is some housekeeping. So if anyone in the audience has any questions to the speakers, please write them in the Q&A chat. We will discuss them in the later part of the event. So to start with the discussion, can you begin, what is heterodox and pluralist economics? And what was your main motivation to delve deeper into this space? We can start with Surbhi first.
Okay, thanks Devanshu and the team for pushing this rather important conversation. And what I'm gonna do is kind of, while trying to address your question, I'm going to talk about what is the politics of knowledge creation itself and kind of try to relate the two. So I'm just gonna try to share my slides. Devanshu, are the slides visible?
Okay.
So first of all, the question of what is the need for a critical theory? Why do we need an analysis of pluralist economic thoughts or an engagement with heterodoxy? So I think the basic question when you're talking about heterodoxy or pluralist thought, the issue is, what is mainstream? What is it contra to? And mainstream economic thought, mainstream is any theory that is in the mainstream of economic thinking. Why does it become a mainstream theory is generally contested, because a lot of times people think that it's because the theory is more true and is more objective is why it is in the mainstream. However, what we are going to argue, or rather what I'm going to argue here, is basically that it is not simply on the basis of the objectivity of the theory or how true or how good it is. Rather, it is dependent on a large part on the politics of that particular historical juncture as well. So let's kind of try to think about what is our world of first best that we are trying to kind of achieve. What is it that we are, we think about that through our economic thinking and through this entire understanding of what economics should do, what is it that we kind of wish to achieve? So I'm going to start with this idea by Samuel Bowles, who says that in one of his old 1974 paper, Economics as Servants of Power, he says, what we want is equality and democracy. By equality, we mean, by equality, we mean the absence of involuntary decisions of wealth or consumption and the obliteration of racially or sexually determined social roles. By democracy, we mean a process by which people can exert a substantial influence on those institutions, the policy, the family, the workplace, the community, which govern both our individual self-development and the evolution of our society as a whole. Uncannily, there's a very similar sort of idea of what democracy, what equality, and what is our world of first best that Amartya Sen talks about. And while we invoke Amartya Sen actually draws from Karl Marx in order to understand what that world of first best is. And in his understanding, his famous idea of development is freedom. So he says the underlying motivation, the focus on freedom is well captured by Marx's claim that we need is, so I quote Marx here, replacing the domination of circumstances and chances over individuals by the domination of individuals over chances and circumstances. So what we are talking about is a society where these social institutions, social and political institutions, and difference in power is not governing how humans act and react. Rather, human agency is able to have the freedom in, or humans are able to have the freedom or have the agency over these different social and political institutions. So that is something that kind of we talk about, sorry about the background noise, but that is something that we talk about as one of the primary understanding of what is it that we are trying to achieve. So the question then becomes that does economic thinking or the tools available with the mainstream economic thinking allow us to have such an analysis of structures of power, of, you know, these sort of understandings of freedom, and whether it provides the framework such that we can progress towards such a society. Now, what I'm going to, while kind of starting to make that point, what I want to talk about briefly is that in much of the mainstream economic theory, there's a stress on objectivity. But can a social science, which is trying to understand a lot of varied and variegated social process, in some sense have some basic objective principles by which we can understand it? Or is there a role of power in shaping the discourse such that when there are different schools of thought or different ways of understanding and a social process is available, which of those become the supreme or becomes the objective theory is then determined by the power structure in the way the discourse progresses itself. So what is the implication of such an objective understanding of economic principles? Generally, anything which does not side with power, the economics that does not side with power, therefore is not able to be that mainstream dominant discourse which kind of pushes the entire conversation. So what we generally do is when economics is producing economists, when we do not introduce students to different schools of thought or to a pluralist economic thinking, what we end up doing is basically training students in a lot of tools within a given framework, where they are not provided with the ability to step back and question the frameworks itself. Why is it that when there are these n different schools of thought or these different pluralist schools of thought, why is it that I get to work only in one school of thought? What is the implication of choosing that one school of thought? What is the implication of not realizing that there are different ways of making sense of the same object? Now, so this is a very interesting, in 1991, the American Economic Association on Graduate Education in Economics said that, so this was one of the conclusions that came from their long report, which is a very interesting report actually, which says, the commission's fear is that the graduate programs may be turning out a generation with too many Edean savants, skilled in technique, but innocent to the real economic issues. So over the years, a lot of economic institutions are churning out students who are innocent to the questions of power, questions of distribution, but rather are extremely skilled in tools, tools to analyze things in a very particular way without being able to understand the different ways in which you can make sense of the world out there. So how can pluralist teaching produce critical scholars, which is something particularly in this current juncture, it becomes really important because we are at a crossroad where, you know, after the 2008 economic crisis, a lot of mainstream economic hegemony has come to be questioned. We need new ideas, new ways of making sense of the world. But even now that hegemony has not been questioned to the point where, or rather we do not have a lot of training in other alternate understandings which can replace what is now the mainstream of economics. So what I'm going to say is that so the question about how can pluralist teaching produce critical scholars? What I'm going to talk about is that are different theoretical schools of thought that we're talking about, what is the implication of it? What is the implication of choosing one school of thought over the other? Is this about, you know, right kind of tools that we are getting? Or is there some fundamental difference in those theoretical entry points in analyzing this society and in finding the kind of solutions that we are interested in finding? And solutions, I mean by the, you know, quotes that I began with. What kind of society are we even thinking about? So what are these different schools of thought and how do they differ? What I'm going to draw from Resnick and Wolff's framework, where they talk about defining a theory based on its entry point, where in Marxian analysis, class is an entry point to understanding the questions of the economy. In neoclassical thought, a lot of what is kind of understood can be, you know, kind of can be reduced to individual preferences, resource endowment, and technology as some of the basic building blocks. Then in Keynesianism, I mean, in the Keynesian idea or the Keynesian economics, it can be kind of reduced to mass psychology, power of institutions, and animal spirits governing investment decisions. Now, these are the different entry points of the theory because the moment you choose an entry point, you basically analyze the entire economy through that particular lens. Now, my decision of choosing a particular entry point doesn't just dictate whether that entry point or whether that theory is right or wrong. Rather, what we are doing in that choosing is saying that this is our view of the world. And this is how we, so I'll get to that point in a brief bit, but another aspect of the theory is that of the logic in which a theory works. A lot of, neoclassical and Keynesian theory, basically, and even to some extent, the determinist Marxian theory, believes in some sort of a reductionism, where a lot of ideas can be reduced to individuals in case of the neoclassical theory and in terms of structures in case of Keynesian theory and in determinist Marxian to some sort of a class determinism. But the non-essential Marxian theory is then talking about over-determinism, where you're saying that there are class and other non-class, which might be social and other aspects, which together co-constitute each other and produce the reality. And similarly, now based on this, all these different theories then produce a very different analysis of exactly the same issue, whether it be income distribution, poverty, capitalism, and I think Ihsaan's going to probably touch upon a few of those points. I won't get into the details of it, but each of these would then have a different understanding of each of these issues. So how does one choose a theory per se? The reason for choosing a theory, therefore, is not simply about there might be incorrect tools in a theory, and within a theory, they progress and get better over time. Every theory within its framework is contesting and is producing better understandings. Within neoclassical theory, there's been immense advancement in, you know, evolutionary economics we're talking about, or we're talking about behavioral economics, and they have made immense progress. But do this remain embedded within the basic neoclassical principles, or do they move away from it is something that still yet remains to be seen. How much can behavioral theory, despite its critique of the early neoclassical theory, get away from, or rather break away substantially from, the individual-based analysis of issues is still something that remains to be seen. So there are these contestations that happen within the theory. But more than that, if we take a step back and kind of look at these theories as different understandings itself, then there are political consequences of the theory, which is something which is why a theory might become mainstream and which is why we decide what theory to choose. I'll just wrap up in a minute. But what I kind of want to say here is, for example, neoclassical theory is premised on humanism, where the essence of the economy is that of an individual, which then goes in line with the ethos of capitalism. Keynesian theory, on the other hand, says that capitalism, if managed, works if the state intervenes in correcting these imperfections. Whereas Marxian theory says that capitalism, even in its best form, is an exploitative system. Now, do you get this sort of an understanding if you were to start with a different theoretical entry point is something that you wouldn't get? And that is exactly why you choose these different theoretical entry points, because they're making sense of what is the best solution, what is the best case scenario in its own distinct ways. Now, can history tell us something about how political terrains and discipline of economics intersect? Of course it does. And there, I think one of the main central understandings is that of, look at the entire post-war capitalism, capitalist development in US. You're talking about a period from 30s to 70s when Keynesianism is the important theory. And post-70s, what starts happening is there's the US oil supply shocks and other sort of economic and political situations change, and there's this rise of Reagan and Thatcher, and you have a revival of the late neoclassical theory. Now, during 30s to 70, even liberalism is actually on the periphery and is not a dominant thing. Hayek has been talking about liberalism and individual way, you know, around the time when Keynes was talking about his ideas. But the reason why certain ideas become dominant and others don't basically depends on the politics of the time. And any radical theory, by its very nature of being radical, remains at the periphery. And it is that sort of an understanding from a political lens, because by the very act of choosing a theory, we are making a political choice. And it is that understanding that we need to question, that we need to self-reflect as to what sort of a theory or what sort of theory takes me to the closest understanding of my truth. And I guess I'll just make one last point. I'm sorry, I think I'm overshooting my time here, but I guess I'll just make one last point, which is in terms of, you know, every theory, within theories, there are these different understandings of that, whether you rely on facts to prove something. But can you ever capture the entire reality by facts is one question. I mean, I depend a lot on empirics on my own work, and Ihsaan definitely does more than I do. So of course we are people who do derive understanding of truth about about using empirics, but whether there's a complete reliance on saying what I see is this absolute truth that the empirics are showing me, something that we need to self-reflect and question. Or there could be a rationalism strand where you're saying that, look, we cannot capture all facts, so what we need to do is rationally form a logically consistent theory. But alternate theories would talk about these non-absolutist epistemologies, where in our process of choosing the theory, not only are we deciding that one school of thought or one understanding is better for me understanding the world, but rather it also forms the truth. It also produces the truth that you are analyzing in distinct ways. And it is at that level that this choice of what we need to do as a critical scholar becomes important. Not, yes, progressing and being so, therefore going back to Bowles, Sam Bowles ends this thing by saying that what is then the role of an economist? It is both scientific and political. Scientific because we have to maintain that scientific temperament and rigor to analyze these questions, but also as political, because in our choosing, we are making those political choices in an everyday basis. Thank you. And stop sharing.
Yeah. I think, yeah, that was great, Surbhi. I think, yeah, this all connects back to, you know, this idea of political economy again, like, you know, you cannot have talk about politics and economics the way you ended. I think the quote was quite interesting. I think, Ihsaan, I'll give it to you now.
Thanks. Gotcha.
Hi, thanks so much for inviting me. That was extremely interesting and articulated, Surbhi, as always. So I'm going to share screen. Can you just tell me if it's showing fine?
Yeah, now we can. With your background of data, now we can see that other screen.
Yeah, you outed me for empiricist that I am. So I'm gonna, after that kind of excellent high level background from Surbhi, I'm just gonna focus on a specific example, which for me was a motivation for why I went to, why I'm going to UMass, which is a kind of heterodox university. Some background for me is that I'm from South Africa, which is kind of the most unequal country in the world, driven mostly by a history of apartheid, settler colony, then white minority rule. And so I'm gonna be talking about this gripe with economics, which is how inequality is dealt with. And it's really an example of how kind of mainstream economics fails to adequately address one of the possibly the most important issue of our time. I do want to give a caveat, though, that I can't claim to be a heterodox economist. My research is pretty mainstream. I'm a grad student trying to get there. So sorry, that's not what you expected. Okay, so I mean, for me, there are kind of two prominent economic stories. The one story is about growth. So if you ask, I mean, I'm not sure what your undergrad economics courses were like, but kind of some courses really open up with these two facts. The prominent economic story of growth, you have this hockey stick pattern of great growth in the last two centuries. And you can see here, it's a cross for Britain, India as well, China more recently. And then a second kind of very prominent story more recently, which is about inequality. And a lot of you will be familiar with the work of like Piketty and so on. And just getting from the World Economics database here. Let me get a laser pointer. That's great. This is from the World Economics database from Piketty and so on. You can see here the bottom 50% of national income share. Really, this is kind of two things. One pattern, which is across the world, is that there's extreme inequality in pre-tax income across the world. You've got for Europe, only 20% of total income is taken by the bottom 50%. Or for the world, only 10% of total income is received by the bottom 50% of the population. Obviously, in a kind of equal society, you'd have 50%. This is only 10%. Now, South Africa and India are actually quite similar in terms of the recent trends. You can see here for South Africa, it's very low and also declining. The share taken by the poorest 50% has been declining over the last 30 years. Similarly for India, steep decline in the last 30 years. And so this is really inequality is kind of a central question. We want one of these an answer, and the kind of the approach in the mainstream has very much been to separate out the question of general efficiency in production from distribution. So separating out efficiency from inequality, and that's really in the kind of mainstream narrative liberates economists from actually really delving properly into the question of distribution. So economists really focus on efficiency and largely leave distribution for another day. Of course, this is changing. There's some increase in recognition. Even these graphs over here are from very much Piketty and so on, who was very much as popularized inequality. But the fact remains there is little emphasis on inequality. So this is from a paper, I think a year or two ago, that kind of surveyed papers that were published in top journals in the last 30 years, so 1990 to 2018. We can see here, so if you look at all the papers that just mentioned discrimination, only about 100 were published in the last 30 years in the top 10 journals. So you can think about the top 10 journals in total have published about 10,000 papers, and only 1% of those papers have mentioned discrimination, which is just the kind of incredible reflection of the lack of attention put on the issue of inequality within mainstream top journals. And even within these, this kind of 1% of papers, the 100 out of 10,000, it's discussed in a very strange way, only in terms of statistical discrimination or tastes. And from my perspective, and perhaps for many of you in India, immediately when you think about inequality, you're thinking about bigger questions of structure. You're thinking about kind of the history of century of colonialism, of patriarchy, of race, of caste-based hierarchies. These are really what we think of the sources of inequality. And so to think about what's the alternative, the Heterodox does kind of look at this question directly. So the Heterodox, for example, does address the question of power directly in the Marxian approach, for example, by saying that inequality and growth in capitalist production are really linked by the concept of exploitation. So this is when workers are paid below what they produce, and kind of the owner of the firm, the boss, takes the difference. And kind of that's extremely intuitive. And if you ask the kind of non-economists, what's driving inequality? What's the reason for the difference between the bottom 50% only having 10% of total income and the enormous shares taken by the top 1%, by the top 10%? It's really the immediate answers are about exploitation. And yet the mainstream, for a large part, really operates on a model of kind of perfect competition, no rents, and so on, against a lot of evidence that is increasingly coming up that obviously there's a lot of rents and exploitation. Marxian approach also, and general heterodox approaches also offer kind of a much more structural understanding of structural group inequality. So we've got things like discussions of racial capitalism. You look to kind of incredible heterodox authors such as Cedric Robertson, Walter Rodney, William Darity now. Social reproduction. Look to Sylvia Federici, Nancy Fulbright, many others. And there are, of course, many other important heterodox theories that really look more structurally at this question of group inequality. The last thing I want to say is that kind of there is some kind of more recent engagement in the mainstream. And so one way to think about group inequality or think about exploitation is through this set of tools given by Monopsony and developed by a kind of heterodox scholar, Joanne Robinson. The kind of empirical methods are very much within the mainstream, but it really gets at the more structural tools of how to understand inequality. And so an example here is that recent estimates from the US context really show that if you look at the amount of exploitation, so what is the markdown from productivity? What percentage of what a worker produces is taken as profit? It's really somewhere along the line of 20%, even in the US context. And it's much worse. Exploitation is much greater for kind of low-wage workers and for low-wage sectors, art, accommodation, and food. And these kind of estimates, empirical estimates, are really showing that there's much more exploitation also in the global south of women particularly, of Black workers particularly, and so on. Okay, so I'll stop sharing. And I hope that was just a general example of something that the useful example of something that the mainstream is kind of as inadequately addressed, and that the heterodox tools really offer something to say about.
Thank you, Ihsaan. I think that really introduced towards what I think you started to portray what the global south, especially in South Africa or the India context, we're talking about, like the inequalities. And I think one of the reasons, from my own personal experience, I learned a lot about consumption in my economics courses, but never the production side. So like, you know, we are starting to introduce what is heterodox economics. So you get to know about what is production, the production side, which is, I think, useful to, you know, differ. But, you know, in the mainstream, it's a lot of focus on the consumption side. So I think that is an interesting distinction. So like, just to move on what you were also talking about. So how do we like integrate like this kind of, you know, heterodox economics, the way we're looking at in the global south, especially in the context of India? Like we do have some tools where in the West there's the thing of MMT or, you know, some other policies which can work there. But in the context of maybe in the global south, how do we develop these tools, or how do we talk about in these different ways of thinking what even Surbhi mentioned, and how do we start going on with that? So yes, Surbhi, you can. It'll be good. Yeah.
Okay, so thanks, Devanshu, for the question, and thank Ihsaan for that very interesting presentation. So what I'm going to talk about here is that I do not, yes, of course, as theorists, we need to devise better tools, but it's not that conversation is not happening, and that a lot of tools are not available to at least start exploring. Of course, we need to keep developing it as we go along. So for example, something really basic that I'm going to try to draw out from a couple of my own research. So I'm going to try to actually just share the slides again, because I have some data that I could probably show. Okay. So I guess, let me try to get this to full screen. Okay, is this fine? Okay, cool. All right. So I think so that there is a lot of conversation happening, especially like, you know, the kind of initiatives that Ihsaan's a part of in terms of decolonizing and, you know, the kind similar sort of initiatives that I'm kind of part of. The understanding is that there has actually been a lot of, so the way heterodoxy is excluded, is structurally excluded from, you know, there was a question in the chat as well that, you know, there are very few schools that teach heterodoxy, that do teach heterodox economics. Similarly, there's also been a exclusion of insights from the global south. There have been a lot of work that did exist that were developed from the global south, which never made it to the dominant understandings. And which are not even taught within India, increasingly so. Very few places in India would also be talking about it or engaging with those things. So, for example, there's this recent work that is by Kalyan Sanyal, like in 2007, which kind of became, which is now being accepted as one of the really fundamental breaks in terms of the political economy of development, or our understandings of political economy of development, which still remains peripheral to much of the teaching. So what that strand does is basically it rethinks the process of economic development from a global South-centric perspective. So what is happening in much of the understanding of development, you know, when we begin with this idea of development. So what is development? Underdevelopment as if is a naturally occurring state of affairs, that, okay, people are just underdeveloped. So the third world, okay, think about this basic Lewis model. The third world existing as an underdeveloped economy, and a developed economy, which is the first world, is actually the model that you're supposed to achieve. Now, how that process of underdeveloped development in the third world comes about is something that's left completely unproblematized from the mainstream discourse. And so what becomes this idea of development? Where a dual economy, where there's a coexistence of non-capitalist or traditional and modern or capitalist segment, is basically this dual economy which becomes a representation of the underdeveloped. And a developed economy is a homogeneously modern capitalist segment. So the process of development is basically simply that you have high economic growth in the third world economies, and you will be able to, there'll be a dilution of the economic dualism resulting in the third world economies transitioning to be these advanced capitalist economies. And that kind of became the central understanding of economic idea of capitalist development in much of the economic discourse. But what let's say this work by Sanyal does is basically saying that this process by which this economic dualism of the non-capitalist and capitalist or traditional and modern gets created in the third world is actually a result of the process of capitalist development, which then problematizes the very basic understanding on which all of our development paradigm is premised. And here, I think I'm kind of thinking about this work that, a co-authored work that I did with Sneshish Bhattacharya, which was about, think about something as basic as this idea of informality, which is largely defined, in terms of a lot of these non-standard labor relations, but also a huge part of that is the non-capitalist segment. By non-capitalist, I mean where there's an absence of capital and wage labor relations. So these will be self-employed workers. You see, I mean, go around in Delhi, you'll be seeing a lot of people, let's say, producing some leather products on the side of the road. Sort of thing. So those sort of, where it's just the household-based production that's taking place. So that was seen as the underdeveloped segment or the non-capitalist segment or the traditional segment that was supposed to wither away with economic growth. And what was seen as this model of development was the first world Fordist model where you have, secure relations and the entire production is capitalist system based. But what we've reached a point where not only was there not a withering away of this segment in the third world, rather, even in the first world, there are these informal labor relations that are now being produced. These non-capitalist labor relations are now being produced. So in the third world, there is this, they are seen as this residual sort of segment that continues to persist because we've not undergone that transition. But despite undergoing that transition in the first world, are those relations being reproduced again? So capital in that sense has reneged its promise in two different ways. One, without having to, allowing the third world to undergo the transition because it's an inherently contradictory process. And in the first world, after having undergone that, is it reproducing those sort of informal labor relations? And these sort of understandings still remain extremely peripheral to the dominant discourse. So I guess I'll just skip over this, but basically the point is that this entire idea that these non-capitalist segments are existing just because there's not been enough dynamism in the economy is so misplaced. So, for example, just look at this. These are different sectors, formal, informal, wage labor, etc. So I'm not going to go into the details of it. But this is basically the households, the sectors from which the households derived their primary income in 2005. That's the gray bar. And the red bar is in 2011-12. Which sector are the households primarily deriving their income from? And this has not changed much over one can say, look, this is a very short time period. I agree. So this is a short time period. There's not been much change that has happened in terms of where do households derive their primary income from. So you'll say, okay, it's a stagnant sort of this thing, which is not producing a dynamism in the economy. But even in this short time period, so these are just different sectors at the bottom, self-employed, employers, etc. Now, for the same sectors, if I look at the proportion that have transitioned from one sector to another, look at the amount of transitions that have happened. So what I'm arguing here is that from every sector, around 40 to 80% of households that depended on one sector for their primary economic reproduction have now moved to another sector, and people from some other sector are coming and reproducing the initial sector, keeping the entire structure constant. So there's this huge churn going on in the economy, which kind of questions a lot of what we understand in terms of this unilinear trajectory via which this capitalist transition was expected to happen. And these are questions that problematize the basic understandings that we have, which have gone extremely uncontested even within the global South. We are because of a lack of pluralism, we've also killed the students' ability to think critically. We are working with those blinders where we are given one theory, one tool as the primary tools, and we're supposed to use that and use those understandings to explore the whole thing. I guess I'm just going to take a couple more minutes and kind of talk a little bit about something that Ihsaan started to talk about in terms of identity. In one of the recent survey that I conducted with Ingrid Van Graven in terms of, how is it that, so this was one, so this kind of idea was one idea in terms of how these alternate understandings are not taken into consideration, even when they question some of the basic understandings of the mainstream, even the dominant heterodox discourse, right? And, but on the other hand, and particularly the insights coming from the global south. So similarly, this was a survey that we conducted in terms of, of the top US, UK and global south departments of economics, where we asked them that percentage of economists in those departments who teach about racialized inequalities or role of European colonialism in their courses. So we were trying to get at this question of structural and racial inequalities and not just pinning it on individuals and discrimination and, you know, what Ihsaan talked about, just about individuals discrimination, discriminating because of statistical discrimination and stuff. So what we find is 87% of pluralist or heterodox department economists in the pluralist department say yes, that they do teach about racialized inequalities, while only 38% in the mainstream economic departments. It varied a lot by region, where 86% of those from global south taught about these inequalities, vis-a-vis only 54% in the global north. So what did it depend a lot on? It depended a lot on where are you teaching in terms of pluralist and heterodox department, whether you are scholars based in the global south, as well as those who had experienced exclusion based on race, ethnicity, nationality, or religion. So there is this need of that sort of a diversity that Devanshu was referring to, which become kind of important in understanding this whole issue. But diversity, I don't just mean in terms of identity and representation, but also in terms of ideas. And that is what this pluralist understanding of economics tries to bring in.
I think Ihsaan is, I think he's gone, or like something has happened. I think we just wait 1 or 2 minutes, but I had an interesting follow-up. Like, I was thinking about the question and I just wanted a quick, like, we wait for Ihsaan. But like, you talk about power, especially in the terms of how, you know, in economics, we don't talk about that in mainstream economics, like power relation. So how do we talk about within economics field, like how do we engage with people who are at the top of their experts, like, you know, in the economics department, how do we engage with them so that they try to at least, you know, we talk about our issue and how do we go about with that engagement? Because if they're not there with us, how do we talk about that? I think Surbhi, it's muted, I think, yeah.
So, hi, I think Ihsaan's back, but I'll just quickly answer your question. I think it's not simply about, yes, there is this issue of people based in the top departments, or let's say the senior people you're talking about who work in one particular frame or ideas. But so the survey that we ran, we actually found that people who've just had 5 years after doing their PhD are much less likely to teach about racialized inequalities than those who are, you know, much senior. Mm. So it's like we are producing a lot of these people who are unable to think critically. So yes, while we need to engage, but probably there's limited stuff in what we can do in people who are set in their ways. But now is the critical juncture, or now is the generation who is asking these questions most forcefully, and initiatives like yourself provide the space to do so. Even if this has to come from students asking for better education, that is totally okay. And people who are talking about it, and the people who are teaching us in the classrooms, it's students' responsibility as much to question them. So when the 2008 crash happened in one of the Ivy League universities, students put up this poster on all of their economics professors. I'm just going to paraphrase, but it said, hey, economics professor, why didn't you see this coming? For all that you taught to us in the classrooms, you could not predict a 2008 as big a crash as this. And one, I forget which one, but one of the top Ivy League schools, the questions have to come from us. This is the generation that is going to shape a lot of understandings for years to come. So it's okay if the questions are, it's their responsibility to answer it. Considering myself as a young student in economics as well. So, yeah, okay. That's where the thing can begin.
Sorry, Ihsaan, you can talk about the, like, what of the presentation you were talking about, like Global South India, like that perspective. Yep.
Sorry for dropping off Global South problems. that was, following from that inspiring ending by Surbhi, I just wanted to talk quickly about kind of other reasons for the need for heterodox perspectives in the economics discipline. So in my view, Global South economic spaces have at least two battles to wage within the economics research discipline. One of those battles is ideology, which Surbhi has spoken a lot about. And ideology, kind of really, you can see it in the entry point that's chosen, as Surbhi said, very focused, overly focused, and in a flawed way on efficiency. Kind of you always get the raw ideological leans towards private sector. I want to also give an example of the concept of kind of deservingness, which in at least the South African landscape is a economics concept ideologically, which is very popular amongst policymakers and really finds very strong grounds within economics discipline and relating to the kind of developmental model that Surbhi was just talking about. So in South Africa, you have, for example, a social welfare system where you get grants if you're over the working age of 60 years old, the retirement age of 60 years old. You also get a grant if you're a child under 18 and you're under certain income threshold. But if you're between the ages of 18 and 60, nobody gets a grant. And the reason is because, at least in policy parlance, these people are not deserving. And it's an extremely damaging concept. And it's motivated by exactly this thinking of that, no, if you're able to work, you should be looking for work. And at least in an economic sense, you can find work when you want to, which, as we've seen, exactly with the amount of informality, with the amount of the closure of the formal sector towards marginalized peoples, it's not easy to get work even if you want it. The unemployment rate for South Africa, for example, has been around 35% for the last 30 years. It's very hard to argue that those people are undeserving. Just as an example of a kind of ideological concept, which is really very powerful, that finds grounds within the economics discipline and makes its way strongly towards policy circles. I also want to speak about one more kind of need. So Surbhi spoke a lot about ideology. Also want to speak a little bit about the incentives in the discipline towards funding of the economics discipline. So if you look at the location, the of major research universities, mostly within the global north, funding mostly within the global north, the top journals are all kind of basically all American, some European. The structural incentives of the discipline are very much towards global north contexts. And that really represents itself in terms of what kind of work is valued. And so when you think about just work that is more relevant to a global south context, even away from the kind of, if you're not talking from an ideological perspective or looking at different entry points, you're just looking at what kind of evidence do you gather, what work is most relevant that you put forward. The discipline is extremely structurally disposed against work in the global south. And you can see that, for example, development remains some kind of special subcategory despite most of people living in developing countries, so-called. You see kind of development specialists as a whole kind of occupation. And so there is this massive need to be rethinking economics, both from the ideological perspective and from where focus is put on. And so I'm really excited about, rethinking economics in India as a kind of platform for campaigns and representation and kind of motivation for courageous research, which really follows an inspiring history of heterodox scholars and a tradition which people can really draw on for a more relevant kind of people-centered understanding.
Thank you, Ihsaan. I think what you said at the end, I think it quite reflected on what we're trying to do. And, you know, I think everyone here is trying to at least understand. And like Surbhi said, we all are students of economics. So we're still learning. We want to do something better. But yeah, that is it. I think many and many others would agree that this discussion clearly lays out the reasons for heterodox economics, structural problems, and how to start thinking about these issues. So now we have a bunch of questions, quite a bunch of questions now. I'll go with the upwards. So I think this is directed towards Surbhi. It's anonymous. So as you were talking about rethinking economic development from global south, I was thinking about how to understand economic development from the perspective of an indigenous communities. Looking at India, I have a feeling that indigenous people voices are missing in mainland discourse. It is always that people from the mainland India who are in the power decides what is good or bad from them, whereas many developmental activities are detrimental to the indigenous communities. What's your thoughts on that? I think even, both can have a perspective on this.
Thanks, Devanshu. Yeah, I think this is a question that probably is very relevant to not just India, but South Africa as well as various other global South economies. Probably it's relevant all across the world, right? Like even in every country, there are these power relations that exist between different communities. So when one set of community is representing or rather is forwarding what they think is the best for the entire region or the country, there is of course some sort of there are certain voices that are always subdued. And I think when you're talking about pluralism, it cannot really establish itself unless we go beyond that sort of a power hierarchy of sort that exists. But it's also not that easy to do, right? So Gayatri Spivak's famous this thing, can the subaltern speak? So, you know, this is like an interesting understanding where what he's saying is that, let me put it this way. So every time that I am producing knowledge or I am producing any sort of, I'm doing any contribution to the existing knowledge, in that I am also deciding what becomes more powerful. So in that very act of producing knowledge, I am trying to privilege one sort of understanding and therefore in real terms, trying to provide power to certain sort of understandings. I think all that, and I'm a person who thinks that economists should be way more humble than economists are, because we do not understand the world, and we definitely don't have the wherewithal to change it. But I think in whatever ways that we can, what we can do is basically privilege a sort of understanding that attempts to break these sort of hierarchies, that attempts to provide a space where what thought is privileged, rather there is a democracy of ideas. I am perfectly aware that it cannot happen to the extent that we would ideally want it to be, because such is the, in any society where there are power differences, even in the process of knowledge creation, that will be reflected. And I guess this is some sort of literature that comes from the Adivasi land question in India, where they say that even things like, for example, property rights, which one thinks about, okay, let's transfer the property rights or the title of the land or the forest lands to the Adivasi community. And if you think about it from a very economistic point of view, yeah, that makes sense, right? You're empowering that community because you're giving the private property to them. But on the other hand, there's an interesting critique that has come from a lot of, there's this book that came out, the tribe Adivasi land question in India, which argues, one of the article in that book, edited volume argues that in this act of providing land title, you're actually making that piece of land open for bargain. So actually private firms can move in and dispossess this population and by force or coercion, make it seem like a market transaction and actually take land away from these communities. So this is a perfect example of how, giving this private property right, which is one of the bases of capitalism and is assumed to be, one of the fundamental things in which this sort of thing gets reproduced. But I think the best thing is to advance the kind of knowledge or that kind of space where these power hierarchies break down and where the sort of gatekeeping can be kept to as minimal as possible.
I'll just add a small anecdote that over the last few months, because of COVID, I've been involved in a lot of policy work. And it's kind of blown me away the extent to which, I mean, this is South Africa, so 100 times worse for India. It's blown me away the extent to which the kind of policy process is extremely exclusive and not at all the kind of democratically grounded process that you kind of ideally want to imagine. And it really speaks very strongly towards this interrelation between what we consider a kind of economic efficiency and the need for a kind of proper democratic inclusion, especially of marginalized groups, and often marginalized means the majority of the population.
I think there's one by Afreen next. So Afreen asks, isn't reliance on principle of equality problematic? It being a neoclassical phenomena, ignoring structural differences, maybe rely on egalitarianism than equality. Should I repeat the question? I think it's just talking about, you know, reliancing on the principle of equality problematic. I think talking about, the welfare part. Does anyone want to take that?
I'll give a quick answer just to say that I agree completely. And just to say that also within kind of, if you go back again to my discussion of how inequality is addressed within the mainstream, it's kind of amazing the extent to which a very particular lens of inequality is used. When you think about discrimination, it's kind of like, are there pay differences within a firm by group, by gender, by race, and so on, which is extremely important, but unfortunately seems to dominate a lot of the inequality discourse within mainstream, and really misses a lot of what you're speaking to, which is kind of the most important structural kind of basis of inequality.
Surbhi, would you like to add anything?
No, I think Ihsaan covered it.
Okay, so the next one is again by anonymous attendee. The person asks, how can we concretely work towards creating economists that are able to weigh these theoretical entry points or apply it to their understanding? Is anyone?
I can take this. I think what we're talking about is a problem which runs much deeper than an individual. Because here again, there is this institutions, there is funding that Ihsaan talked about, and journals, the kind of work that gets published, the kind of knowledge that's acceptable. It is something that, I mean, that reproduces these sort of biases and these sort of inequalities. So the kind of people, if it is not, it cannot just be relied on individuals to do that. And like I said, till the time there is a theory that is questioning the global economic order, there's no political reason of why that theory will be accepted. So I guess the only way, my short answer would be to ask these questions in the classroom, which makes people, even if you do not have institutions that are open to these schools of thought or these understanding, I know like there are a lot of initiatives that are now coming up. There's Rethinking, there's Exploring Economics. There are a lot of these student-led and student-based engagements that are there where people are asking these questions. And I think this is the beginning. This is the beginning in the right direction where you start asking these critical questions and that is what will get the conversation going. So there's no easy answer to it and there's no easy way out of it either.
Ihsaan, do you want to add anything? So another one is by Ankush Garg. The distributional issues concerns in welfare economics are always studied under the narration of efficiency equity trade-off. How sensible is that narrative, and is heterodox school liberated of that narrative? That's very interesting.
Can I go first, Surbhi? It's a key narrative which doesn't work and has done a lot of damage. One way that I like to think about it is in thinking of when there is an efficient production allowed, it happens under, there's a certain allocation of returns to individuals. And generally, as I said earlier, it's thought of that these returns can be redistributed afterwards through taxes or through a kind of lump sum redistribution beforehand. But in reality, it's nowhere near that. It's really difficult to redistribute. That's why there's so much political contestation about taxes. Nobody even talks about the big land redistribution question. That topic is given purely lip service to a large extent. And that means that you have these massive legacies of colonialism, apartheid, of continuing reproduction of these social hierarchies, and no meaningful sense of equity. And worse than that, even given the distribution of resources in a society, that equity is often not achieved because people have to protect their interests. If you're rich and you know that you're based on unjust wealth and you're exploiting your workers and you've gathered your wealth through illegitimate means, which is basically everyone, then you're gonna not be choosing the most optimal, efficient allocation. You're gonna be choosing the allocation that protects your position. And so it's really something that becomes extremely important now when inequality has become more of an issue in the discourse, but also specifically in global South countries where political contestation is so much, to extent, less institutionalized.
Surbhi, do you want to add anything?
I think
at the next question is, I think it resonates with everyone who is here. So if you want to become a heterodox economist or work in this space, are there only these few schools, UMass, like some in Italy, et cetera, that we have to end up? To rely and understand these issues. I think both of you could have some experience on this.
I think the unfortunate thing is yes. That's what would my understand. I mean, the schools are not that limited as well, because I think a lot of time people also want to go to just the top schools or those which give you better prospects in the job market. So these things, these choices do come with cost as well. So, you know, there are a lot of brilliant people like Ihsaan himself, who could totally get into an Ivy League place, but choose to be in a UMass Amherst because of a UMass Amherst, of course, being the best the heterodox has to offer. But also that is in that sense, like a political choice. And but even within India, you have these places that provide such sort of my majority of my education has been in India. I did my PhD at South Asian University. For 1 year of that, I was with UMass Amherst, but much of my understanding of political economy and heterodox schools was from my basic graduate education itself. So there are these schools and I think there is a lot of literature out there. Increasingly, there are So you can check out things like Union of Radical Political Economics. They have interesting resource of syllabi available on their websites and some very basic ones that even if you know you're not exposed to a lot of that yourself, you can go and look it up. And they're very pluralist in nature and you can look up these heterodox syllabi. I know Decon is going to put out a whole list of resources on pluralist strands and you can engage with more of these communities So there is a lot of material available out there, even if you're not being taught by someone or in an institution that promotes these sort of ideas.
I'd also have to agree, it's an extremely difficult and unfortunate situation where, I mean, for myself too, I felt like in order to pursue, to understand broader understandings of pluralist theories of economics, I had to kind of go to the global north. I want to say two things about that. One is that heterodox spaces in the global north can also often have its own problems. Culture is sometimes, mainstream culture has a lot of problems, but heterodox culture also has some problems. And then also, because a lot of these heterodox institutions are placed within the global north, there's still that struggle to have heterodox within the global south while you're at a global north university. And it's an uphill battle, which you either give up on or you go back and pursue trying to establish and support research bases within global south countries. Which brings me to the second thing that I really think that groups such as yourselves, Rethink Economics for India, are extremely instrumental in creating these institutions that provide global South heterodox understandings. In South Africa, a lot of these movements towards heterodoxy only came after kind of campaigns from students kind of demanding decolonization of curricula, which entails a kind of broader, more relevant global South understanding of the theories that were taught.
Okay, so I think we have 10 to 15 more minutes left. I think a lot of questions still. So Vinayakan Sajeev, he asked that, is there any study conducted on teaching trends among Indian economics professor in teaching caste-based economic inequality? I think, Surbhi, you have some thoughts on this. Yeah.
So no, but one thing that we recently filed an RTI, so at the university where I'm based, Azim Premji University, we had an RTI festival where so RTI is basically the Right to Information Act, where you can file an RTI whereby government has to respond to those questions. So like it's a binding law in place. So what we did was basically try to find out at the levels of assistant, associate, and professor in economics, what is the caste distribution? And it's an extremely, extremely unequal one. The number of, so this was a question about central universities throughout the country. And you actually see this extreme over-representation of forward castes in these institutions. And there was some Indian Express article on it, I think a while back, last year or early this year, but we are going to put out something on it pretty soon as a blog post. And we post it on Twitter and stuff like that. And we'd probably try to post it elsewhere as well. So not particularly on this question as a survey, but we've been thinking of moving in that direction and I'll keep you posted. And that's definitely a question you all can explore as well. And it's a very important and relevant one.
I think, yeah, that's great. We'll all be looking forward to that. So another one is, if the first world itself isn't supporting some of these models, for example, you mentioned informal labor relations, but also stuff like technology rights, then is the broad development goal just wrong on both ends or just more inapplicable for the global south?
Okay. It's definitely wrong on both sides, because let's think about what is it that we're talking about when we're talking about development. Development, even though it's, you know, so this Vinay Gidwani in his book cites an author where he says that development is as loosely defined as progress. It gives you an illusion that you're progressing towards something better, but it's actually a very value-laden category. It's not a value-free category that you're just making a better transition. So when we're talking about development, it's basically capitalist development. So that is something that we need to be absolutely clear on, that what do we mean by development? It's not a value-free category. So what we are seeing in the global north, that is basically a contradiction inherent to capitalism itself. Now, that discussion itself will take us, you know, one semester course on internal contradictions of capitalism, and probably I can't get into it right now. But so that is what we're talking about, the global north. But global south, the issue becomes even more enhanced, because the development of global north, even its golden age of capitalist development from 30s to 70s that happens, is highly dependent on colonialism. So this pre-World War II, this entire industrial revolution and everything that happens has a lot of its roots in colonialism. And if you read Dependency and everything, you know, the entire argument about development in the North and underdevelopment in the global South is basically a result of a common historical process. So it's not that you can follow the same steps and kind of become develop. And there's been a lot of recent works on it, like Harjun Chang's Kicking Away the Ladder, of how, you know, North progressed and how South cannot progress in the same way. But to kind of pin down on your question, that this is a problem of capitalism itself, but it affects both the regions in very distinct ways. In North, it is after having undergone that sort of a capitalist transition, which is capitalist transition core development, that we are seeing this informal labor relation, which points to these contradictions of the system itself. Whereas in the global South, the argument that I was using, Sanyal, to make is that even this capitalist transition that you talk about, a full-fledged capitalist, relations, labor relations throughout, is not possible, because the post-colonial capitalism itself recreates that sort of non-capitalist space. So in some sense, there's a similarity, but in the other sense, there's a difference too. So Review of Radical Political Economics recently came out with this special issue on informality and precarity, where I contributed one of the things. But all the articles there are very interesting, which are actually talking about how does informality in global north and informality in the global south, how do they differ, how do they relate, and what's their relation with global capitalism. So I would definitely recommend giving that a read.
I want to push back a little bit and say that, I mean, even though development like is very clearly not adequately captured by mainstream at all, it's still kind of almost the most important question, in terms of the broader goal of rapid increases in living standards of a general population. That question is kind of one of the, as I started out with, potentially the most important question alongside the very interrelated question of inequality in our society. And so it's just to say that it might, it's probably wrong, but it's something that we need to be working on constantly and working towards understanding. And it makes getting the answer right or some insights towards the right answer so much more important.
Okay, so that's a very interesting point, but I think one of the issues that the point is not against development as or better standards of living of people. And that is something that, I would completely agree with you on. But For me, the question is that is the path of development, which is seen as the absolute quote unquote path of development, is that what is through which we'll achieve these better living standards? And kind of that's what I was trying to allude to, that for me, the question becomes that we all want better living standards, we want an egalitarian society, but the kind of growth process and the kind of development process that has become this objective understanding of development, can we achieve that through this is something. And yeah, I would love to hear more from, I mean, that's, I think, an ongoing debate between you and I, like, and how to understand development itself. But yeah, so that's the only thing I wanted to kind of clarify.
Yeah, I think this particularly for Ihsaan. So the anonymous attendee says that, Ihsaan, you mentioned the battles heterodoxy has to wage. Another battle which a heterodoxy has to wage is that the theoretical and empirical front. Can you speak to this, keeping in mind the distinction between heterodox micro and macro theory and empirics?
You know, I think this is probably the toughest question that for myself that I've like been grappling with since I started my PhD. So I don't know where I fall within the heterodox spectrum, but my personal view, which I could very well be wrong, and I'm happy to have very robust disagreements with people about, is that empirical methods within heterodoxy, as it leaves a lot to be desired. I think that there's a lot that's wrong within the mainstream. From a theoretical perspective, and the heterodoxy is kind of quite strong on attacking from a heterodox perspective. But from a empirical perspective, I think the kind of move towards micro-empirical evidence is actually something that the heterodoxy should be learning from and hasn't adequately taken on board. Of course, this is not to say that micro is the only type of evidence. It's definitely not to say that. It's also definitely not to say that quantitative evidence is the most important. So just want to make that clear. But it is also true that like there's been 20 years of kind of very insightful development from the mainstream in empirical methods. Even if you think about the quasi-randomization methods, difference in differences, the way big data is analyzed, all these things potentially are extremely powerful tools for the heterodoxy's own theories. And so for me, it's a kind of question that really has been a bit of a divide in my personal viewpoints of heterodoxy versus mainstream. And I think the way forward is for the heterodoxy to really be taking on board a lot of the empirical innovations from the mainstream.
Surbhi, would you like to add anything?
I don't actually disagree with Ihsaan on that. I know he was expecting me to. But I do think like there are very powerful tools that are available with generally the empirical sort of advancement that has gone, which we can import. But my inhibition will only come from, I think one thing we have to, at least I think, is that tools are not without biases as well. Tools carry theoretical biases too. Whether you think the system can be put in a deterministic framework is something that in itself, whether a causal regression framework can capture or not, is something that you have to grapple with. And I don't think there's an easy answer. Like I said, I myself depend on a lot of empirical work, definitely much less sophisticated than the kind Ihsaan does, but I definitely do depend on a lot of empirical work as well. But one thing that we need to be clear on, and which Ihsaan mentioned as well, is that to then assume that only the empirical work and, you know, well done empirical work is the only rigorous form of work is also as problematic. Like, yes, those are very important, but it should not just then simply be that, okay, an argument that is theoretically laid out is not as rigorous or not as robust, because that's also where a lot of gatekeeping happens in really top journals as well, where you're making an extremely powerful argument, but it's reduced to some really basic tools that you're using. And, you know, what sort of knowledge then gets accepted there can also just depend on that. And we go back to the problem of, you know, being very, very well versed with tools while missing the big questions. So I think these are those, and there are no easy answers to it. But I think it's just that knowing that these are powerful tools that we import, but also knowing the potential pitfalls. I think that's where one needs to strike a balance.
So I'll just, you know, finish up with these two questions. So, this one is by Roberta. Like, so how do those in the global north support heterodox in the global south? Be great if both of you can have some ideas on it. I think everyone is.
Asking if Ihsaan wants to go ahead first. I think Ihsaan's internet has stopped. Hello. Oh. Okay, I'll go then maybe.
Yeah.
So, okay. See, I think in this very question that we are asking, how does global north kind of promote this thing in the global south, we are already creating a power dynamics. Why are we assuming that this push towards a more, you know, heterodox or a global south centric understanding needs to come from global north? This entire thing about creating this hierarchy is something that we, if we really want, you know, to the extent, like someone again raised that point that can the people who are not in a position of power really raise? So I agree that there is that big lacuna, but to the extent that we can, it doesn't need to come from global north. It doesn't at all need to come from global north. Some of the most important peasant movements that happened in terms of establishing the right of peasant workers was actually saying that they want to replace or rethink about rural areas as the center of development, rural areas as where the progress or where the new Indian thought would come from. And the moment we go in these geographical positionalities in terms of hierarchies, and we assume that that's where the quote unquote good knowledge or, you know, that will come from, we're reproducing those hierarchies. And that is exactly what needs to be questioned. There's a lot of this thing happening in terms of how the decolonizing movement, there's a lot coming from Global North. And I think some of the Global North scholars have done amazing work in it. But there's no reason to be waiting to get that here. It's now. It's now that you break those sort of hierarchies. So it doesn't have to come from the Global North. It can come from Global South as well. Ihsaan?
I'm so sorry. That was completely unintentional and bad timing. I missed what Surbhi said, but so this may be repeating, but one thing to add is that to not, whenever there's interactions between Global North and Global South heterodoxy, to not get too wrapped up in the Global North kind of narratives, which often are extremely relevant, but also often might not be.
And so the last question, I think everyone has been asking about this, is I think both of you too, what are some of the best and most accessible resources for beginners to get an intro into the heterodox and pluralist schools? So yeah, maybe you can give some resources or like books to people here. Yeah. Yes, you can start.
You should ask Surbhi for her syllabuses and just read all the references that she goes through, which is excellent and really gives an amazing overview of pluralist approaches to many different aspects of economics. In general, I think actually looking at heterodox syllabuses is actually a good strategy. And those will give references to good books as well. Yeah.
Thanks, Ihsaan. And Ihsaan's actually provided me long, extensive comments on my syllabus. So he's been really helpful in me to design those as well. But I agree with Ihsaan. So like I suggested, that ERP is a really great resource, Union of Radical Political Economics. And if you can get hold of syllabi by other professors in Heterodox University, that's great. I think there's a terrible thing that's happening with the copywriting of syllabi, which we should all oppose. I think it's a great thing to have a repository of syllabi. One book that for a very basic understanding that comes to my mind is basically Contending Economic Theories by Richard Wolff and Stephen Resnick, which kind of has a chapter by chapter analysis of each of the theories. It starts with neoclassical, Keynesian, Marxian, late neoclassical, where a lot of behavioral and evolutionary stuff also is there. And so which is also from where the last chapter is what I was drawing from in order to kind of make that point. So that's what I would suggest. Sorry, Devanshu, if we have just a minute more, there's one question on Sanyal. Can I respond to that?
Yes, you can. Yeah.
So he says, with regards to Sanyal, his book critiques the entire gamut of development economics to make a basis of something new with Sanyal experience. But in my reading, the theories of capital's need, world systems dependency theory, amongst other, also capture the quivial nature of capital and non-capital. So Sanyal in his book engages a lot with these theories, all three of them. But he also mentions very clearly of how he's departing from it, because look at capital's need, right? So what you're saying is that non-capital doesn't have an independent existence of its own. Rather, it exists because capital needs it to exist. And that, I think, is a mistake that, I mean, I shouldn't say mistake, but rather one of the lengths of analysis that we use for a lot of theories. We are now at a point in history and we look back as if everything that happened was only to get us to this point. So, you know, that teleological view of history. But it is not possible to look at history only from the lens of today. So what Sanyal and others would argue is that non-capital doesn't just exist to satisfy capital's need, because there are, in all of these theories, be it world systems, particularly like if you think about Ray and Wolff's and their capital's need understanding, even in that, the kind of underlying issue is that this non-capitalist segment would wither away unless there's an unbalanced trade. In case of a balanced trade, since the capitalist segment is continuously expanding, so it would wither away the non-capitalist segments that exist. So, you know, that entire Kaleski debate. What Sanyal actually does is basically he's arguing that the logic of capital itself reproduces that non-capital. So in that sense, it's kind of subverting or saying that it's not that it's existing because of capital's need, rather it has its own independent existence, but it comes into being by an internal process of how post-colonial capital develops. So that's one thing. But yeah, we can have more discussions on Sanyal some other time. So feel free to write to me or something. Yeah.
I think, and that's great. That's great. So just to end off, I think another resource which I'm learning also is also Exploring Economics, which they have a nice introduction to heterodox and different schools of thought. And also as Rethinking Economics India, we're also working on creating an open source repository for pluralist economics. So just, you know, be updated with that. That is it for our first event. I would like to thank Surbhi and Ihsaan for coming and getting started with the first event of Rethinking Economics India. Thank you so much. Thank you to our audience. We also have a series of events on informal labor in India in October. So please follow our social media channels to be updated. If you want to get involved as a volunteer with RE India or start your own local chapter, please follow the sign up links in the chat. And we will share the recorded video on Slack and on request also. So thank you, everyone. It has been a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you, the panelists, for coming in. And thank you, everyone. Thank you, Surbhi. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Bye, everyone.